sky.co.uk, sponsors of Sky Arts.
Iggy Pop is quite rightly considered one of the most important innovators in rock and roll. He was lead singer with the Stooges, a band infamous for their uncompromising live performances, mixing sinful riffs and Iggy's own drug-addled misadventures with cream pies and broken glass, etc. Maybe it's no wonder that he's usually referred to as the godfather of punk.
Like a rock star, I'll sing like a rock star.
That's where a lot of these songs came from.
It's not encouraged to grow up.
Well, you know something, David.
I've never heard anything like this.
And I'm going to give you a countdown on 5, 4.
Every creative expression is a snapshot of a moment.
Iggy, when the Stooges got together first, you got together for friendship reasons. What was the motivation in 2007 for the Stooges getting back together?
I had a similar feeling. I had a relapse of a similar feeling when I brought them down to Miami, the two brothers, to play with me. And I felt like it was somebody I knew. That's a little different from saying it's somebody you like, but it's close enough. So there's something familial that goes on within the group. Not to put too fine a point on it, I was an only child, raised in a fairly bleak surroundings, not relatively so, but just as I became more worldly, I realized that your average Midwestern trailer park next to a corn row in February, it's pretty damn bleak. And I found maybe half of what I was looking for in the group. And then as one is inevitably in all human relationships, the other half was a hell of a big disappointment. I had to pack my bag at some point and go live another life, and finally, things brought me back. The other half was public response.
Yeah, well, or would the other half be, would people just shut up asking me for 25, 30 years if the Stooges are going to get back together? Let's just do it and it'll stop people asking the question. Could that be part of it?
It crept up that way. I was just sort of surprised. It the way I experienced it was more gig, I got a gig offer and I was too busy, and I kept saying, no, we can't do it. I haven't got time to do a gig with these guys. And then I was getting calls from the very sharp and opportunistic A&R at my record company saying, Rolling Stone's calling me. You want to do some more tracks for these guys? So things, took me aback, and it was really one thing that led to another. I didn't think the demand was there.
You had been soloing for a long time. You had collaborated here and there, obviously. But I mean, back with these guys again, was it like, oh God, what am I doing here?
Yeah.
But then you have to get through that and it works.
You have to get through that and work. And the work I did with them when I was quite young was, it was intensive. And part of the calculation, one of the ideas I had when I asked them to form a group was, we're gonna get a house. We're gonna all live. It was communism. It was an exercise in utopian communism. We're all gonna live in the house together, and that experience is going to allow us to create something unique of our own. The reality is, in a week, there's going to be the plumbing's going to be broken. There's going to be puke in the sink. Mm. There's going to be a nasty girl in room 3 that somebody wants to get rid of. There are going to be cops at the door. Various disappointments and disagree. You know, all these things, cash flow problems. So it was very intense and difficult work, and you only know half of how difficult it is because you're so young. And then really for me after that, I followed the same sort of path when I worked with David Bowie, when I sort of experienced the collapse of the group. The idea was the same. It was all socially based first. The music just was supposed to kind of come out, and it was all loony, which is the nice part. I always had faith in the nonsensible parts of the business. I always thought if you could present something that really wasn't so sensible or with the flow to people in a nice, neat way, they'd go for it. I just didn't realize that you needed lots of people to go for it. You know, the business pressures. Well, a little bit of success was enough for me as long as I could play my music.
But were you trying to make sure that you were in charge of all the business in those days? And are you doing less of that now?
No, I wasn't.
Were you micromanaging kind of thing?
In the old days? Yeah. No, I didn't even know. I had no idea. There was no business ever. No, on the contrary. Au contraire. No, I was your basically completely untenable, pure artiste until I hit about 30. And then from about 30 to until I worked with these guys again, I just sort of slogged it out within a narrower field, got a little more sensible, got into a position slowly but surely of relative independence and power. And the music went within a narrower field. And then when I started working with these guys again, I tried to recreate some of that by insisting that as soon as we started playing gigs, that we begin getting together, traveling to get together at our own expense, without any backing from my record company or anybody else, to write. I said, look, we're doing well here. Research and development is part of modern corporate life. Let's plow something in. And we tried to always do that in personal houses, mostly mine in Florida, and keep it intimate and small.
Yeah.
So that was the...
And away from the dress for success type New York's LA.
Yeah, and even away from the receptionist. Because she could blow the whole vibe, you know.
Right, yeah.
The receptionist or the other band was going to walk in and make a comment about your shoes, or whatever it is.
What do you think I want to do? That's right.
When they write the 100-year history of rock and roll, like, you know, Iggy gets a chapter, there'll be 10 paragraphs on that house, the Fun House, which is what it's called, which is the name of one of the albums as well. The fact that you'll get a full chapter and all that, the fact that people refer to you as all of these things and that now your time has come and that you're before your time, that you're the godfather of this, I mean, after a while, does it rankle with you or do you go, oh, listen, leave that kind of stuff out? Or I get the impression that with the Stooges back now, you might be a bit proud of it. Like, you know, like, take these titles, like, you are the godfather of punk and all this, and be happy with it. Come on.
I get a laugh out of it. At first, it was embarrassing, but it was really embarrassing the first time I had sex and the girl called me Iggy, too. So, you know, after a while, I looked around and all of a sudden I was really comfortable being Iggy. Took about 25 years. I guess, you know, what do they say, what's in a name? You know, once something enough goes into it and you gain a certain pride or affection for the, especially for the music, you know, then that's cool. But yeah, The Godfather, that bothered me for years. I always thought I needed, a hotel gig and a cape, you know, but at some point, it just gets to be, I've been so many things. I mean, I've probably had 50 shifting titles, a lot you would have never heard of. I think early in Detroit, it was The Man You Love to Hate. That was that for a while. And then it was something else. And then I was a junkie. And then I was a poet or whatever, you know. And people go through these things and, you know, it's history will constantly be written and rewritten.
Okay, but hold on. If I said Godfather Punk, let's go to something different. Like, for instance, what you were doing was taken up by, and I'm not asking you to slag somebody off here necessarily, but was taken up by Alice Cooper, was taken up by Kiss, was taken up by Ziggy Stardust, who created something other than themselves from watching what you had done. And they made an awful lot more money out of it for various reasons. Mm-hmm. Number one, Kiss had a huge cross behind them, you couldn't afford one, which lit up at every single gig. And it was all theatrics, it was all part of the gig, it was showbiz.
Yeah.
You didn't get the showbiz, didn't want the showbiz. Did you ever think that the drugs got in the way, you got in the way, or that success, except on your own terms, was all you wanted, and therefore you didn't want that?
I suppose some drugs got in the way, but ultimately, just had more to do with there are different rewards for different virtues in this world. I'd still rather be me than any of the people you mentioned. I'm real happy being me. And it was, our stuff was never designed to make a buck. Once I got to a certain point in my life and looked around and realized, you have to make a buck whether you want to or not. Then I kind of got on that, and I've made some bucks. You know, I don't have the pride in that I have when I put on certain of the recordings I've been part of and listen to them and go, and get almost a giggle of glee because I know damn well they're out there where other people feared to tread. They're more for real, I think, and they're just better. But I do get a kind of a grim, all right, got some bucks for that,
yeah.
got some safety for that, you know. But probably one of those people who's always, I had a late manager, wonderful guy, who arched his eyebrow at me one day and just says, some people thrive on drama and crisis. I think he was trying to talk to me, so I may be one of those people.
Drama and crisis, one of those things that you mentioned earlier on was fueled a lot by drugs. I mean, I don't know if the Stooges were kept together by LSD and fell apart by LSD, but by the mid-70s after that, when David Bowie did come along, did he save you from heroin addiction? Did he save you from bad stuff? And by the way, can I just say also, while I'm at it, did you save him? He needed you as much as you needed him.
There was a nice exchange there, and I think that he had offered to work more with the Stooges a couple of times
You had met him in Max's Kansas City when you went to sing for Rick Derringer's band. Isn't that the first time?
Yeah, I met him in Max's.
Yeah.
And the group had folded for the first time. The group folded twice.
The Stooges?
Yeah, once the original Stooges folded in 1970, and then I had become unsound. And the group folded again in about 75. for good until the new century. And that first time, he was around, and Tony DeFreeze, his manager, was around, and they seemed to be on a mission to establish a U.S. beachhead in New York and in some way to co-opt certain elements of the U.S. underground. And they were...
See, there you go. There's no way you'd have done that. You would, like, that's almost Machiavellian. It's certainly, like, that's really
so... It's a different, it's a different take on things.
So different. I mean, like, Lou Reed here, Iggy Pop there. And this, I'm not giving out to David Bowie.
He had good... you listen to the records he was making at the time, and his particular position was that he had very... They're good, solid, finite skills that could be applied anywhere, really. And I think that became a great musical strength for him later. Sure. A few years later, he was, you listen to Station to Station, and I keep thinking of, it's kind of Tony Newley singing to a jazz band, a black jazz band, but it works. So he had some very nice skills, and he wasn't sure where to put them. Whereas I would say maybe what my band, we really knew where we wanted to put it, and the skills were really basic and sketchy. And and I think with Lou Reed, he had a similar problem. He had a skill range which was awfully interesting to certain people, but then to the rest of, especially America, where people are, you're raised to be a spud in that country. Nobody knows where they are, for Christ's sake. They've just learned to sit in chairs. And, they just scratch their head, really. Listen to that stuff. I say we will have a real cool time tonight. I say we will have a real cool time.
He did open, the collaboration with him did open the European door to you big time. Britain, Germany, etc., didn't it?
It opened it, no. It opened it this way. It got my ass over there. Mm. Once to England, and then again to Europe. But once those records came out, at first, a lot of Europeans just scratched their head and said, who is this weird guy with Bowie?
Right,
And the records got attention, half because of his involvement, half because they were very good. Half the reason they were very good was because he was really good on the records. But when I would go out live to play, except in London and Paris, where there were people who just had been waiting 4 years at that point to spit on me and pogo in my face, The rest of Europe, they just couldn't care less. But I really liked Europe, and I was just excited to have a look around and see it. And I didn't know I was doing so badly, because I'm a funny guy that way. So I'd go to Sweden, and there'd be 20 people at a fairground throwing fish at me, and like, you are a funny man. And I was excited to be there. I was just, I played my music in Sweden. I went to, or wherever it was, I went to the, over the border from Bosnia, wherever I was going. And it took a while before it caught on, actually. And I would go up the north of England and stay in these little weird lodges with, you get a little single pallet bed and makings for tea. You get a kettle, and it's unpolished wood, and once I was playing Leeds, and it was one of those pubs where the night I played, they had a They had one of those sandwich boards out in front telling, like, you know, tonight's special, kidney and toenail pie or whatever it is. And, oh, God. So, but after a while, something happened, especially after Lust for Life.
You mentioned earlier on, Iggy, about you know, the trailer park growing up business and that. Like, hold on, your dad was university educated English teacher in school, and you were living in a trailer park.
Yeah, dad's a wonderful man. He just passed away, and then I'll be happy to get done with this tour and have some time at home to come to terms with that more. Yeah, he was, because he had also, my father had been orphaned, and he was raised during the Depression, as was my mother. And both of them were raised by people who had lost. They'd lost everything.
He knew the value
and
of
had
the dollar.
They'd retreated to their country cabins in Michigan, where I was born. And I think that you know, that experience, and then on top of that, when he got to the age at which I started to pursue my boyhood dreams, and he started to pursue his, there was a Second World War. And thank you very much, you're now required to go to a stinking jungle for 4 years and possibly get killed and forget about he wanted to be a baseball player originally, forget about that. And then when you come home, support this brat while you try to put yourself through school that you never had a chance to do because you were off working. So I really understood it made him, by the time I was old enough to observe him, it made him a person who was very much concerned with things not going wrong, and he just didn't want the burden of, are you a homeowner?
I am.
Do the pipes burst?
Absolutely.
and then you get not only a big bill, but you get some weird guy that said he was going to show up at 10 in the morning. He shows up at midnight with a gold chain, stinking of beer. And says, yeah, I'm a plumber. And you're like, and we've got you by the balls, right? You know, and then they raise your tax. And then then the value of your property goes down, but you borrowed on it. So, you know, he wasn't looking for that. So that was why we were in the trailer camp.
And is that why when you went to school, which is a very uncool thing to be doing at Ann Arbor High School or whatever, and you tried to be the, whatever the word is, the main guy, or you went for the class sort of nerd, whatever the word is, and you went for that, I was going, wait a minute, Iggy Pop tried to be the main guy in the class. I associate that with the moron. Explain that.
I was innocent. I was an innocent
you
kid.
You saw their money and you said, hey, I wouldn't mind a bit of this.
I did see the money, and I saw, I want to be part of that groovy life. I didn't know exactly what that life was like, but I knew that looked pretty more impressive than and more the norm than mine. My dad made sure that the trailer park where we were living was in the Ann Arbor school system.
Right.
Had it been, it was nearer the bad town, Ypsilanti, where kids, he had been a teacher one time, and it was tough black kids and hayseed hillbillies up, unskilled labor, up from the south to work in the war plants mostly. And had I been raised there, things I might have wanted to conform to that ethic.
Sure.
I might have ended up trying to mastermind some sort of robbery or something. I don't know.
But yeah, there was some of that, and then also just, I mean, I'm a vocalist in a band, and a lot of them got kind of a big mouth, so I just kind of gravitated to, you know, I enjoyed civics, I enjoyed English lit, I enjoyed debate, I enjoyed school politics, until I got my first drum kit. And then it was like, this feels good. Here's something that feels good from the inside. Yeah.
And your parents loved you so much, they moved out of their bedroom and they let you rehearse.
They gave up their bedroom.
In the trailer.
Yeah, later, when I was trying to put the Stooges together and work out what was behind a Muddy Waters song, I had a spinet piano in the living room that my mother rented for me and took up half the living room. And they definitely went about 20 extra yards with me. So in a way, I mean, I found out later that I was a spoiled kid compared to the kids who were richer, because I got a lot of attention and care and thought put into what they could do to help me grow.
Maybe I know some people, maybe I break some rules, but this is the street I got to compete. Maybe I ain't no fool, so I take a little bad with the good. It ain't just black and white, you gotta deal with.
The Stooges thing, did you ever see it that it could have gone on much longer, that the fourth album wouldn't have taken another 30 years to do, that maybe it should have gone on for another 5 or 6 or 7 years?
We could have done, how about this, we could have done more than we did.
But you know, the Iggy thing that you mentioned earlier on, you mentioned Jim or whatever, because like your real name being Jim, you allow people to call you Jim and you allow people to call you
sure.
Iggy, right? Okay, like, I mean, you're not going to go in and see the police and go, oh, there's the lead singer, hi, Gordon. It's not going to happen, okay? Okay, so the point is, okay.
They should,
okay. But like, where's the gap now? Where was it then? Like, if the gap years ago between Jim and Iggy was, say that, is it like... Are you both people now?
That's a really... I never even thought about that. If there's a gap.
Well,
no,
you're right. David Bowie created Ziggy Stardust to make sure to pretend that it wasn't him, because he might have wanted to do American soul music in 2 years' time, or Station to Station with the jazz stuff, as you call it, in a few years after that.
No,
so you had to create something that lasted a certain amount of time.
I'd say fundamentally, the two are pretty much come together. I don't know exactly who I am when I sit here and talk to you, but when I'm working, I know who I am, and that's Iggy.
Although, as he's told us, he was never really to revisit the primal vitality of his days with the Stooges, as a solo artist, he's had more than his fair share of success. And as for the future, well, who knows?
With nobody else.
As a final one then, Iggy. Dislocated shoulder at the moment. You've reached 60. Cartilage lost in your hip. You got knee trouble. You got one leg shorter than the other. Where next for Iggy?
Well, I suppose... another week's work now, and then other than one show in Las Vegas, 7 very nice months spent in the tropics. Probably the hardest thing I'll have to do is pose for Playboy. I think I can manage.
I think so too. Thanks a million, Iggy. Come on yourself. Thank you very much.
Well, baby, go out.